Thank you, everybody, particularly to Eleni and Yanis. This is always a very exciting experience. And this morning, I seriously was thinking, okay, let's go to the seaside and take a more Italian attitude to things. And then I said, no, actually, let's go to the conference and let's talk about sex. So I have to start with this question. This will be, yeah, another Italian attitude, of course. So I have to start this presentation in a very strange way, but if you bear with me throughout it, you will see that there are some logical arguments in here. I'm not totally mad yet. I like this one. This is a piece, the one you just have seen. It's called The National Panties, and it's about the return of fascistic discourses inspired either from the left or from the right in the current political economic situation. And it's a project that I started in Manchester. It's a collaboration with FACT and several international institutions. I want to sort of point that out because body politics will be the main part of my presentation today. The second thing I wanted to show you briefly is this. This is the Leonardo Electronic Almanac called LIA, which is a publication together with the MIT Press, supported by Saban University, Casa Gallo, in fact, University of the Arts London, which is a Chelsea College, Wimbledon, Central St. Martin's, and etc., Goldsmiths University. These are just some of the partners that we have for that. And there are all different sorts of publications. We are still able to do things both online and as print. So you can get the print from Amazon and it's still available online. So we're trying to avoid students and academics and etc. to spend money. I don't know for how long we will be able to give it up, but we're able to do it for now. This is something new. I have decided to found and direct a research center which is called Operational and Curatorial Research in Contemporary Art, Design, Science, and Technology. And what it will do, it will focus on actually action, creating things, and the things that it creates are publications, projects, exhibitions, and different sorts of endeavors. And generally speaking, there are with internationally established institutions from Chelsea College to the Courtauld, from MIT to the Royal College, and etc. So this is just to give you an idea. I'm going to open then with the sex after the publicity, and I have to explain you something. I won't be able to explain you all of this video, but you will be able to enjoy it. There is an expression in Italian which is andare a puttane, which means two things: to go to the horse, literally to go and seeking prostitutes, but it also means for things to go bad. Okay? Again, you can interpret and look at that from many different perspectives, from feminist perspective, from the perspective of patriarchal society. And so talking about patriarchal society and talking about body politics, I want to show you what Italy has produced in the past roughly 20 years. And one other thing, he's screaming poor communists as an insult, and that's the Prime Minister in Italy.
Bunga, 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 b società. Ogni avanza faccio un figlio, io lo chiamo Pieremiglio, se prende di Versiglio, se la femmina non sarà. Lo conosco ormai tutti, il mondo mio, se l'Italia va a buttare voglio andarci anch'io. Cosa fare mentre aspetto il cancelliere che giunga?
It's called a mashup, and it's very popular on young people, much younger than I am. But interestingly enough, as another point of cultural export, by the Royal College, the new building of the Royal College on Battersea in South London, exactly by them, there is a pub slash restaurant that is called the Bunga Bunga. Why am I talking about this all of a sudden? Well, there is a reason. We're going from this into what you would call probably the proper presentation, but this is actually part of the proper presentation. And we're moving on to Machiavelli. There are several problems. I have several problems with the representation of the body politics, with the representation of the state, the way in which morality. But more than, I don't like to talk about morality, but I like to talk about ethics, the way in which the state has suddenly become unethical. And I received a remark yesterday because, you know, with a glass of wine, we were just talking about things. And I was saying that Machiavelli disjoined. I didn't use the word disjoint, I just say, you know, Machiavelli separated morality from and ethics from politics. And I was told that I simplify things. It's a good way, it's a good insult, because it tells you, you know, you're kind of stupid and you're childish. It's a passive-aggressive way that, you know, the state also use, people use in order to make a statement. I prefer to make more reasoned statements. So in order to look at what actually is happening within contemporary society, what is the violence? Because of this paper, the paper that I'm going to present, it's about trauma and violence. How do we construct violence? What is happening today in our society? Are our societies preparing themselves for another wave of violence to which will follow, again, trauma? In different forms. So I did a bit more of in-depth research. Machiavelli is someone that I read. Now there is quite a lot of analysis and critique on Machiavelli. And one of the analyses looks a lot at actually at this text as a parody. So this is not really a book that Machiavelli wrote to give political advice. But since he wrote other texts which were satirical in nature, there could be the possibility that this is a satirical text, and therefore you can start seeing the connection between parody, satire, and the video that we have seen at the beginning. Nevertheless, in the discourse of satire and parody, the repetition seems a reinforcement to me, and this is something that we mentioned, you know, when Charlotte was talking about the small picture. It seems to me that laughing, smiling about a series of events that see underage girls, and when I say underage girls, it becomes a very vague area, people that are under 16. And so you wonder, for example, I start wondering, immediately under 16, it means a statutory rape, okay? To see all of that transformed in a satire, in a cultural product that diminishes the reality and the gravity of the events, that focuses willingly and unwillingly on the representation of the female body only as an object, that replicates a certain kind of patriarchal attitudes within the Italian system, to me is something extremely problematic. Today, we can easily talk about the loss of ethics in every single aspect of our society. We can talk about the loss of ethics in the banks. The state has no ethics any longer. The state is a state that has to look at the economy, has to be managed in an economic manner. And the economy does not have any longer any links to the well-being of its citizens. And so I wanted to go back to Machiavelli. I believe that this depends upon whether cruel deeds are committed well or badly. I did not know that we could speak of cruel deeds that are ethical. I'm very surprised. And so when we say that Machiavelli separated politics and ethics, morality for me is very transient, it's very temporal, it's too small of a time frame, it's a very dangerous one. But ethics is that I feel more comfortable with it because it's more stable. I think about human rights, the things that should be respected, the respect for the other, minorities, different genders, different ways of thinking, that may be mainstream or not mainstream. Interestingly enough, every time we belong to a group, within that group, there is somebody that does not fit. And that somebody is the other, is the marginalized. And we can see it in all different sorts of ways. We can see that bullying has become, or has probably always been, a part of human nature. Because this paper is not really about, you know, the body politics. It's about human nature, and it's about the fact that do we have a responsibility for the things that are happening today in our lives. And can we actually possibly do something? Is there a realm in which we can act? Let's go back to Machiavelli. They may be called well committed, so we can do cruel things, and we can call them well done. If one may use the word well of that which is evil, when they are all committed at once, so we can commit cruel acts if we do all of them in a single moment. So if we kill millions of people in a short period of time, because they are necessary for establishing one's power and are not afterwards persisted in. So, for example, I kill 2 million people, but then I don't keep on doing it. And I raise my hand and I'm saying, I'm sorry, there are 200,000 people that are jobless, or there are 500,000 people that are jobless, and now as a society, because we no longer have responsibility for anybody, we leave them on the side. So, because they are necessary for establishing one's power and are not afterwards persisted in, but changed for measures as beneficial as possible to one's subjects. So, of course, we're doing this because they are beneficial to people. Is it then, to my question comes to my mind, is it beneficial to say we are saving the state, or we're saving the the economy of the state, or receiving the state for 1%, 2%, 5%, even for 51% by destroying the other 49%. But, you know, even if the number is 90% and destroying 10%, abandon 10%, that is big cost civilization. But we committed that those that are first a few in number, so the bad evil acts, which is kind of strange, but are those that are first a few in number, but increase with time rather than diminish. Those who follow the first method can in some measure remedy the standing both with God and with man. Those who follow the second cannot possibly maintain their power. And so, interestingly enough, there are two discourses here going on in Machiavelli. One is about preserving power, and it's about doing bad things, basically for the good of the established order, but in the name of God, and to keep that name, that special relationship. But the second part is that power cannot be maintained. And that to me is very, very important, because those who follow the second cannot possibly maintain their power. So it becomes impossible for some people, sorry, I just need to look here at the board what that is. So it becomes impossible for some people to actually keep power just because they're seeking power and the sake of power. And so here is the second part. Here the question arises, is it better to be loved than feared, or vice versa? I don't doubt that every prince would like to be both, but since it is hard to accommodate these qualities, if you have to make a choice, to be feared is much safer than to be loved. For it is a good general rule about men that they are ungrateful, fickle, liars, and deceivers, fearful of danger and greedy for gain. I still, you know, in many ways struggle to find the parody in this text. I find it a bit difficult. I'm not understanding exactly why and what technique is creating a parody according to a certain line of the critique that there is. While you serve their welfare, they're all yours, offering the blood, their belongings, their lives, and their children's life, as we noted above, so long as the danger is remote. And so the big question here, it is actually about the nature of humanity. It's about the relationship between the nature of humanity and power, between the nature of humanity and the body politics, the politics of the state, of which then in the end we are part. But when the danger is close at hand, they turn against you. Then any prince who has relied on their words and has made no other preparation will come to grief, because friendships that are bought at a price and not with greatness and nobility of soul may be paid for, but they are not acquired, and they cannot be used in time of need. People are less concerned with offending a man who makes himself loved than one who makes himself feared. And I think that this is it's an important characteristic. If we're going to expand this and we're going to be thinking about trauma and violence, we realize one thing, that love, according to Machiavelli, is not a response. And the response, the art of masculine response, it's actually that of strength that is feared. The reason is that love is a kind of obligation which men, because they are rotten, will break any time they think doing so serves their advantage. But fear involves a dread of punishment from which they can never escape. Now here he is talking about the subjects, so he's talking about the citizens who are rotten. But because he's talking about men, I would like you also to consider one other thing, that oath breakers, people that break their promises, are not just the citizens, but also the princes. And I'm going to go now to mention one particular book, which I think is very problematic in many different ways, and that's Jean-Jacques Rousseau, A Discourse Upon the Origin and the Foundation of Inequality Among Mankind, which is about humanity being inherently good. And this is a question that I have had now, 45 years old, and probably for roughly 40 years. Are men good or are men bad? Or men, women, slash. I don't like actually to put women there, because I think in a way women have a different, quite often a different sort of perception of life compared to men. But while Rousseau is promoting an idea of a man that is in touch with nature, that is, a perfect individual, Machiavelli presents a different sort of society. So the question is, what kind of societies do we have? What kind of societies we have inherited? What kind of body politics are we experiencing today? And so this was the title of the paper. After this introduction, reactions, inheritance, and memories, genetic transmission of trauma through blood and neurons. How this all came about, I will try to explain to you how all of this came about. There were several papers, several discussions on the nature of trauma, but also on the influence of the trauma, of the scar, of the violence onto the body itself. So on the body of the individual that then comprises and composes the body politics, which is the body of the state. And I thought always, in a strange way, that there is something like a cultural inheritance. It's a cultural inheritance that can be psychological. Your parents have experience war, experience famine, you tend to have more food in the house because the rent can repeat, and you feel more comfortable by having more at your disposal. I remember this is a sort of news that didn't go very far, but when the first Iraq war was declared, there was a form of neurotic and adaptive behavior. That's how it's called. It's a psychological expression, it's a psychological definition. A neurotic and adaptive behavior, which was simply this one. The people in Italy started to rush to supermarkets in order to buy flour, sugar, fruit juices and things, because they thought that the impact of the Iraq war would affect them in Italy. Why? Because they had experienced a war. It was a very strange, panicked reaction. It was a neurotic and adaptive behavior. And I think there isn't one that can be characterized better than that. So we have inheritances that can be transmitted through nurture, simply by the parents, culturally, through their sons and so forth, going on. And then after a few generations, they may disappear. But I always thought, there must be more than that. There are behaviors that in animals, for example, they are instinctual, you're born with it. And so the big question that I have and that I wanted to think about is, are these behaviors that we have, these experiences that we have, can they actually be genetically transmitted? Can they actually alter, for example, neurons? Can they alter our genes? And can they therefore be inherited? And can they, for example, shape a different form of brain, a different way of thinking, a different way of reacting, a different way of engaging? It is a long shot, I'm aware of that. Nevertheless, it's something that I like to analyze and like to think about. So I went back to the body politics. Mirzoev expands the traditional presentation of the body politic to incorporate a theory of perception. After all, he writes, sorry, that's a mistake I did, the involvement of the spectator is the key to successful representation of the body politic. The body politic is, after all, a myth which can ultimately be sustained only by consensus. And it's, if you start thinking about all different sorts of war, all different kind of conflicting cultural engagements across the world, then all of a sudden you start thinking about our personal participation within it, by participating within its mythology, by replicating its cultural expressions that are linked in a way or the other, nevertheless not directly celebrating, but certainly creating a framework of rejection, a framework of suspicion, a lack, a constant lack of trust. So I thought about Roman Barthes, I thought, okay, there are quite a few images after a bit of this, so we can relax after that. I know it's a bit... Connotation generally consists of masking the signification under a natural appearance. It never presents itself under the species of a system free of signification. Thus, phenomenologically speaking, it does not call for a declared operation of reading. To consume a connotative system, in this case the rhetorical system of fashion, but it can be that of politics, it can be that of society, you can change that, is not to consume signs, but only reasons, goals, images. And strangely enough, okay, what we had is with Barthes, the repetition of, in a way, the danger of consumption of the images, because in the moment in which we are consuming the images, we are consuming the ideology that is beyond them, we are consuming the goals that are there, goals of which we may be directly or indirectly unaware. And this becomes extremely problematic, because it creates a structure, a phenomenon, to which Barthes doesn't find a solution. Mirzoev doesn't really have a solution on how do we escape this mythology in which we participate through consumption of images. And this is mine. This is one of my thoughts, and it's about the construction of space. This is a personal space, a space where the identity is personally negotiated. When the identity is actually beyond ideology, it doesn't belong neither to this nor to that, but it's based on a rational analysis, on an interpretation. And for me, the construction of space, the construction of the personal space, is extremely complex, and I don't think that we can actually construct physical space. What I think is that there is a contribution through the postmodern democratic processes in inverted commas, which are minimal. We can construct an interpretation of the space by presenting alternative usages, collages, deterritorializations, and recontextualizations, able to offer to the future viewer the emotive decoding of the space that we lived in. So I don't think personally that we're going to be able to directly influence and change society, but what we can possibly do is to offer different forms of interpretation, and these different forms of interpretation, they can become an emotional, more than an emotional, an emotive journey, a journey of emotion for other people in order to understand what was happening in a particular period of time, in order to construct for themselves another rational, logical interpretation, analysis of that particular period in its complexity. And that's it simply because, you know, I don't think that there is a truth to be distributed, and even if there was a truth to be distributed, not everybody would want to hear that truth, not everybody would want to experience that truth, and I've never been an advocate of shoving the truth in the throat of people. You know, we can agree on all different sorts of methodology, on all different kind of approaches, but for me, personally, I think that the only valuable experience is the personal experience, is the one-to-one, or the one-to-three, the one-to-five, but is that experience where you have the possibility of intelligently, calmly, analyzing, different issues and giving space to opinions that may be totally contradictory and totally different from yours. But nevertheless, those opinions come from experiences, come from different itineraries, come from different emotive journeys. And just for that reason, they have a right to respect. What is ethology? Ethology is the behavior of animals, and if we espouse the thesis that we have, that we are sort of animals, then we have to ask, is a cultural ethology, is an analysis of the cultural behavior of humans possible? And is this one presenting the genetic inheritance of culture as a possibility to be considered in order to describe and explain human behaviors, which are species-specific, pan-human, and presumably genetically controlled? Because what we forget is that the body has its own genetic way of controlling our emotions, of controlling our brain, of controlling our neurons. What I'm going to do, I'm going to jump a few things because we have 5 minutes, and I'm going to just jump to the pictures. Here you have the Aldrovandi Cabinet of Curiosities, 1522, 1605. It's a collection of objects. Here is another form of the Cabinet of Curiosity. In many ways, these are almost, there is a trait to this that is imperialistic. And you can imagine, for example, in the Victorian sitting room, objects coming from different colonies. So I wanted to do a particular work, that would look at trauma, war, violence. And because some of our behaviors are determined, yes, by genetics, but they're also determined by chemistry, by the chemistry of the body, by the adrenaline, by the electricity of the neurons firing. So I decided to concentrate on the chemistry, on the blood boiling, when the blood boils in your veins. And one of the things that I did was to collect feathers from a dead stork, because that represents, in a way, trauma and violence. They affect children, and they affect the way in which the brain develops. There were some slides before that were focusing on exactly how that happens in a physiological way, in a physiological manner. And nevertheless, they still, even if these are broken hopes, they still produce a different sort of landscape that can move on and create different things. These are the bones of a turtle. And I liked the turtle because we imagine them always attached to their homes. There is a mythology, again, about the turtle to be one thing with the home. The moment in which the turtle loses the home, the turtle dies. And I thought about displacement. Is displacement, human displacement, that? Is the connection to the place that we have something that we cannot live without? And actually, I think that for us, for humans, probably we're luckier than turtles, if we look at it logically, and less emotionally. So the piece that you have seen in the gallery, it's about basically the bones of the turtle. It's about images of conflict. You can see, for example, on the on your far right, on the top, that's the keratin, the scales in inverted commas that cover the tortoise shell, because this is a tortoise, it's not a turtle. There are some objects that are created in terracotta, and they are sort of representative of the lines of explanations that we try to create in order to rationalize something that cannot be rationalized, in order to create a chemical structure that can explain things that actually cannot be explained. And you can see that actually the piece in itself, that it's broken. Where there is the feather, it is actually broken up. And again, there is this idea that erosion as a chemical process. It's something that continues. And interestingly enough, we were talking about the possibility of returning. Can we return to a place? Can we return to a place that has been destroyed? Can we return to a place where violence has happened? And the problem is that once violence happens, that is permanent. There is not going back. And even when we create utopia, create mythologies, create representations of these worlds as perfect worlds, first of all, we have to remember that they are mythologies, that they are utopia. They were never that perfect, and in any case, even if they were perfect, as the paradise to which we are supposed to climb to the back after being expelled by God for committing the sin by eating the apple, it is a place to which we cannot go back to, because we cannot go back to in time. Do I have time to show a video? I, as you can see, I'm very neurotic. Oh, sorry, the video was already there. I don't need to do this. Let me see if I have it. Yeah, I have it. Okay. So what I want to do, because I have been talking about a different form of representation, a different form of engagement that is not necessarily patriarchal. You know, we have been looking at some issues that are related to violence. We have been, in a way, condemning the testosterone, and we have been looking at parity. In Italy, in the past 20 years, homophobia has increased. Why? Because it threatens the masculinity of the state. It threatens a certain kind of representation of the state. Nobody was more vocal against any form of homosexuality in Italy than the president himself, surrounded by people that then repeated that sort of discourse and exasperated it to polarize society in all different sorts of ways, having then an increase of homophobia within the country. And this is, again, a parodic response that I thought is actually very good, because when I look at certain kind of political ideologies, when I look at the structing, at the way in which the information is shoved down the throat of people as a truth to which one has to bend, if we look by the same people that, or by the same ideological group that would have condemned Gramsci and tried to condemn Gramsci as an heretic, and today they use him as their own intellectual backbone, or that made Pasolini's life miserable and that today present him as their own cultural icon, I find that extremely contradictory. Particularly when we speak about openness, when we speak about reception, when we speak about acceptance.
Yeah.
And like the English say, I think we have to put our money where the mouth is. And I'm going to close this presentation with this piece, which I think you will enjoy very much. It's not a parody. One thing, it's made in Italian-English mix. So you may not follow all the... It's a pastiche. The language is a pastiche. So you may not follow it exactly, but you kind of get the sense of it.
E nella famiglia crediamo che deve essere fatta come quella che è costituita da un uomo e da una donna.
The family is done, only by
noi governeremo questo paese, le unioni omosessuali non verranno mai equiparate alla famiglia tradizionale.
Non saranno mai possibili le relazioni tra i figli
né per le coppie
The speech is to say that we are against the ideological testosterone. I would prefer to be gay.
Lanfranco, thank you very much. Are there questions? Nadia.
I found it particularly interesting that you refer to quotes from the Lampard's text, Meet Today. I think it's Meet Today you were referring to.
Yeah.
And you suggested that the emotive journey, a return to emotions, is the only way out of this impasse of given perceptions. But the problem is, does this suffice? How can we go beyond our inability to imagine and perceive the other, as the Lampard puts it himself? And the otherness is reduced to and boils down to sameness in our society. So probably the emotive journey is not sufficient. I leave it to you to give us whether you have made any other
comments. Yeah, I can use a Greek word, which is sympatheia. When I think about emotions, I think about a suffering together. And I think that brings you closer to other people, brings you closer to their understanding. The moment you meet, you share sufferings. Because then we have to, you know, we would have to distinguish what kind of emotion. It's a very complex discourse, and I agree with you. But that, for me, is about the sharing of the experience. It's about the sharing of the journey with the limits of the communication that we have. But, I cannot push it further than that, because the reality is it's such a complex world that cannot be reduced to a world of, right and wrong. Nevertheless, I can say this, that to institutional discourses, I prefer the interaction between human beings, a human interaction which is an emotive interaction, which is a sharing of experiences and sharing of understanding, in order to overcome impasses, in order to overcome violence, in order to reconcile trauma. And I know that it sounds very idealistic, and I'm a pessimistic person, but my pessimism is determined by my idealism, and nevertheless, I will keep it up, I will keep on fighting, because I have met many wonderful people in my life, and that's what keeps me going. Thank you. Thank you so much for your question. It was really good, and I'm too proud. Thank you. Yes?
Thanks for the lecture. Also, regarding Roland Barthes, I mean, you showed Roland Barthes, specifically the text you showed is the naturalizing phenomena, something he did so well, naturalizing structures and so on. And this proposition you have about culture being transmitted genetically seems to do exactly the opposite, because it goes into naturalizing essences. And the second thing, and I'm not sure why you need it also, but anyway, the other thing is also that if you suggest that culture is indeed transmitted genetically, it's also again going to this, just like economy took over from politics, contemporary society, also culture took over from the social as the main kind of criteria. So it goes somehow by also kind of elevating culture a bit further.
There are several good points made into that. One thing that I wanted to say is that it is an area that I'm looking at. What I think that is culture transmitted, really, I think is the trauma, more than, an idea of general culture, okay? So I think that, for example, we can almost, as much as possibly we can have a cat with an instinctual fear of water, we may have created a society where we have an instinctual fear of the different, of the other. And this becomes important, but it becomes important insofar it helps us to understand that certain kind of phenomenon should not be happening, and therefore we should be going back to birth and to denaturalize all different forms of the, aspects, cultural aspects and cultural manifestations of images, and even realize, even better realize how these images and how this behavior and how these constructs can actually shape society, can shape humans across centuries and millennia. Having said this, this is, this is the first phase of an experimental work. I'm possibly going to Symbiotica in Australia in order to try to carry out and see if effectively, because at UCL they have seen that trauma modifies physically neurons. So the physicality of your neurons, brain's neurons, they change physically due to trauma and violence. So the next step would that be, are they inherited or not, and how much would they really affect them, etc. It is a very vague research. Nevertheless, I find it sort of fascinating. And I find it fascinating for the problematics that it raises, for the problems that it creates. And it almost tells us, in order to create a different society, I don't want to necessarily define it better, but I want to define it different, a society that possibly is more peaceful, and then we have to seriously, reconsider the way in which we engage with each other and we engage with all different kind of minority groups and differences and try to solve conflicts. That's what really underpins it. Thank you so much.
I don't want to say hello to the students. I will try to be there if we can for my question first. I have some questions according to society. So I will try to give some quotations in order to follow up with the question. So first of all, in the holy prototype, Kazantzakis said that Ποτέ οι Έλληνες δεν έκαναν την τέχνη για την τέχνη. Και τα σώματα, λέει, τα ήθελαν γερά και δυνατά για να έξω ένα γερό και δυνατό νου. In my free translation, he said that he never tried to think that the ancient Greeks started doing art, or not started, did art just for the art. The second part. Freud said that the leader, and afterwards Goebbels used that, Freud talked about the libido, the powers of libido, and Goebbels said that the leader should have the powers of libido, and then the crowd will get the forces of power control or aggression. Yeah. So my mentor told me that ancient period, the ancient times, finished by the in the beginning of Spartacus' revolution until Christ, and due to Christianity, we have to pass a period of medieval ages where art was not so developed, not so posing, not so strong. And now we're in a period similar to the end of that time, when change has to come, due to the fact that there are limitations because of the economic system that we're living with, and due to technology, the technology, is way greater than the technology that we use. So there has to be a breakthrough. So the breakthrough would be either to go back to a medieval state where somebody will come and he will say that, okay, this and that as Christ, and we will try to give some moral issues in order to try to see, because I gave my mentor, I'm going back to my mentor, he said that the ancient world was based on power, money, technology, and libido. And Christ, all of them, he said that, you know, forget them. And that's why we had the period of no art. So how an artist, in general, how society should form in order not to pass this period of middle ages?
Let's see if I can... Let me try to see. Yes, okay. So that's what I'm coming from a talk that I have given on the cyborg, and it was about the normalization of the cyborg, the concept of the cyborg that has become normal. Interesting enough, again, focused on the futurists. It started from the futurists and then it moved on. It started from the futurists and then it moved on to the contemporary usage of technology. From an artistic point of view, what this will cause, it is very difficult to predict, but I can tell you this, that technology will play a big role within society, within uni, within media, media arts, whatever we want to define them. Now, is libido part of it? Actually, I think so. And I think libido is part of it in the moment in which we're looking at the merging of the body with technology. And there is an erotic desire for technology, for the metal, for the body. I know that sounds very, very strange, but there has been a series of presentations of cultural presentation of the prosthesis as an erotic object. And there is a TV series that has made it even mainstream, where one of the characters called the Richies, and one of the characters has a girlfriend, wife, I can't remember, she has a prosthetic arm, and basically what it does, it pretends to masturbate with her prosthetic arm that she has not attached to her. And when she comes back to the bed, she looks at him, and she scowls at him, she looks at him badly. And then they use the prosthetic arm in order to stimulate her. That is, that is a form of literal penetrative use of the technology. But the point is a different one. It is that there is a desire. This desire is today becoming more and more similar both in men and women, because there were studies where women refused the prosthesis as an object that made the body, while men looked at it as a new form of empowerment. So to have a prosthetic leg, it makes you cooler, and the word cool was repeated across a series of examples. You know what I'm trying to say? I'm trying to say this, that those elements that you have mentioned, the power, the libido, technology, they will be there. And they will be present in the new forms of representation and in the new discourses that we will use. Nevertheless, I have to make a statement. And my statement is that I look at that with fear and horror. Because one of the things that I mentioned was this. I don't know how many of you have seen the movie Lipo Man. Okay? It's about basically people, you know, I'll give you an example. You need, somebody needs, I'll just give an example and then we can, here you can ask me all questions, I'll be here. The movie is about people that get prosthetic organs, okay? And you get a new liver, that's good. You get a new liver, it's a synthetic liver, you have it in your body. Then because you're not paying the insurance company, and so we go back to the body politics, to the economy, etc., the repossessors, they come and they shoot you and take the liver out of you. Now, this seems crazy. I mean, it's not economically feasible to shoot you. What I can do is I can have a microchip inserted into the liver that tells me that you have online, that you have not paid your installment. And what I do is I turn off automatically the liver. And so you start suffering and in pain. I don't have to come there and take your liver out. And then you will find the money and you will immediately pay. So what I'm trying to say is that society, with the invasion of technology within the body, is going to be creating new horrors. New horrors that if we do not change our ways, will create new trauma, new violence. Thank you.
Thank you very much.